water bodies throughout the world continue to be threatened by nutrient runoff. And the visual indicator, algae blooms. The primary sources of this nutrient runoff are aging wastewater treatment infrastructure, ecologically degrading agricultural practices, and stormwater runoff.
One of the points that I tried to make in my most recent book, which has an odd title, Earth, spelled with two A's, one of the points of that odd title was that the planet's already distinctively different from the one we were born onto. Its frozen sections are melting with great speed. Its dry and arid places are desertifying at a rapid pace. Conversely, those places that tend to be wet are getting wetter and wetter and wetter in very violent ways. Its seas have become considerably more acid and are rising quickly. These are enormous changes. There's not a major physical system on the planet that's not been knocked out of kilter.
Stormwater refers to the water that comes off of impervious surfaces. Impervious surfaces are things that don't allow water to pass through them easily. So rooftops and sidewalks and driveways and roads are typically impervious surfaces. And it's interesting to think that these things are all connected to each other. So we build roads to get to developed areas which have houses and sidewalks and driveways. And so roads beget more roads, which beget impervious surfaces.
That water goes very quickly, so it creates flooding and creates problems, as opposed to what in nature, where there's wetlands and all kinds of other ways, the water has a much slower movement, which then also brings the water down and into the ground, recharges the groundwater, instead of rapidly going across the ground, picking up pollutants, and then going into rivers and then into Lake Champlain or to the ocean.
It's going to be expensive to deal with our infrastructure problems. And that expense gets larger all the time because as we think about things like stormwater, there's more of it. Now we've discovered an even more comprehensive, powerful, deep way to screw things up. And we're only at the beginning of it. Human beings have raised the temperature of the Earth about 1 degree Celsius so far. The climatologists tell us with robust confidence that we will be looking at 4 or 5 degrees before the century is out. Warm air holds more water vapor than cold. That means that you get more huge deluges and downpours, more chance for flood. That's what we see in Queensland and Australia. It's what we see in Pakistan. And it's what we see in Vermont.
We're on that steep curve of the exponential curve of change in climate change and in environmental degradation and in a lot of different areas. We're really experiencing rapid change in our culture and in our society. That rapid change means that yesterday's solutions aren't going to work tomorrow.
As intense weather events become the new normal, we are forced to design adaptive changes into our social systems and built environment. And in the wake of recent floods, we are reminded how society continues to modify the functional landscape.
People have responded after floods in a pretty predictable fashion. There's always been the call to dig out the rivers, berm them up, contain the flood. By bottling up all that flow of the flood within the channel, you've now made it deeper and you've made it steeper. a number of years go by, things feel pretty safe. We start putting a house or a subdivision, and along comes a flood. The rivers just explode. They erode their bed, they undermine infrastructure, road shoulders, undermine abutments, and they eventually just blow out their banks because all of the power of the flood has been contained within that channel. There's calls to put it all back. And we start that cycle over and over and over again with each decade that passes. So we're trying to break that vicious cycle where we manage the channel, we armor it, we dredge it, we berm it, because to try to structurally control the rivers, it's not only extremely expensive, it's untenable during these flood conditions that we're seeing now. And we simply can't afford to have that type of management paradigm throughout the whole length of a river. We simply can't afford it.
Go back 300 years and we probably had a really healthy watershed that was capable of taking any kind of erosion or nutrient loads, of which there wasn't a lot because there weren't very many people here, but digesting it in the way an ecosystem digests it. When you cut the forest down, when you put developments on the land, when those developments produce stormwater that doesn't get absorbed on that land, you essentially have that nutrient load going into the lake.
There's a huge disconnect between what we do on the land and how it affects the water. The Lake Champlain Basin is very large and has lots of very far off tributaries, small to larger to medium sized to basically rivers going into the lake, and people conduct land use activities, whether they're commercial or industrial, the working landscapes of agricultural and forested areas. Generally, unless someone really studies it or is interested in broader environmental stewardship, people do not recognize that they live in a watershed. Wherever you live, everyone lives in a watershed.
Different watersheds have different characteristics. There's more forest cover in some areas, more ag cover in some areas, more urban cover in other areas. And so we are going to have to manage stormwater in the particular cases that arise in each watershed.
The boundaries of our towns and cities do not align with watersheds, and this creates a significant challenge when developing strategies and policies.
The laws the country put in place, the Clean Water Act, most importantly on water, really aimed at what we call point source pollution, or pollution that comes out of the end of pipes. To deal with non-point, especially impervious surfaces, you gotta have a plan across the watershed to do that right. So we're struggling to find that framework, not just here in Vermont or Lake Champlain, but all over the country, trying to find a framework that really does address non-point pollution. It's quite challenging.
Part of the solution is for us to walk the talk. We have passed, both at the federal level, the Clean Water Act, and at the state level, fantastic laws like Act 250. What we haven't done is enforce those consistently. So let's recognize first what we have and just make sure that we're living up to the commitments that we've already made through the democratic process when we passed these laws in the first place.
Vermont's Association of Conservation Districts works on the watershed level to conserve and improve Vermont's natural resources. The Lake Champlain Basin Program has been developing a database of critical information over the past decade and a basin-wide strategy to address water quality issues in Lake Champlain.
It is an extraordinarily valuable database that allows us to get fundamental information about the state of the lake and the trends in its health over time. We can't estimate reliably the total amount of water that's flowing based on just a few days worth of data, even a few weeks or a few months. We actually need years worth of data because 1 year could be a dry year and another year a relatively wet year. So understanding those long-term temporal patterns is critically important from a statistical point of view.
What we've got to do is get back to a development that mimics nature, that seeks to look back at nature as we would have found it in a way that wasn't creating the pollution, wasn't creating the flooding risks, and say, how can we, within the context of our modern society, re-engineer our landscapes to build back some of those elements?
These natural design elements must hold and clean water. It starts simple with rain barrels that capture water during a rain event and hold for later use. Rain gardens absorb water diverted from rooftops and impervious surfaces.
Justin Kenny with the Winooski Natural Resources Conservation District. It's an organization that is one of 13 similar organizations throughout the state, so we're all broken up into geographic areas, and we work on natural resource issues. So this is a rain garden that we're building at a residence in Montpelier on Terrace Street. So it's actually one of two. There's another one in the back. Both of them are treating different sides of this roof runoff. So the roof runoff that's being treated here is, I believe the calculation is about 625 square feet. You get an inch rainstorm times 625 square feet. That's a lot of water that's coming down. The runoff normally would really just flow over the surface of the lawn, not filter into the groundwater. All of it would end up downhill in the street, and then it would follow the street line, take a bunch of oil, fuel, sediment, trash down into the drain pipe. And the drain pipes here, for the most part, go right into the Winooski River. So, straight out of pipe, into the river. We've gotten roughly 12 to 15 built every year, about on this scale. Some of them bigger, some of them smaller.
Rain gardens can also be placed in urban settings to capture water from parking lots and surrounding buildings. City parks provide excellent opportunities for the integration of stormwater features.
Taylor Park, donated to the city or the area in 1799. It's been here a long time. It's undergone a lot of change. It's going to undergo a lot more change. And one of the things we decided to do, we wanted to build a bigger sidewalk using it as a detention pond. But it turned out the pavers were very expensive. So we looked for other material, and we finally were lucky enough to come up to the permeable concrete. This permeable will take about 8 gallons a minute per square foot. It'll take any kind of rain event. I mean, a downpour will not affect it at all. So you have 3.5 acres of park. All that 3.5 acres, no water gets beyond this sidewalk. So that stays right here in the park, in the groundwater, which is where you want it. This project is to rebuild this sidewalk like that one. It won't be as big, but it'll be a lot more important. What we're going to do is cut the curb every 8 feet. And all of the watershed between here and the next street up on Lincoln Street and from Fairfield to Bank, where you have all these roofs and all these parking lots, all that water will now, instead of going into the storm drains, will be filtered out right into the groundwater and keep it out of the lake. So this is the enemy. This is the straight shot to the lake. That's what we're trying to do, is make that necessary only in the very worst storm events.
Urban settings provide significant challenges, as space is limited and water moves swiftly across the impervious surface.
We're at the St. Albans Park and Ride, and we're in the Stevensbrook watershed. We're looking at a gravel wetland treatment system. It's an innovative treatment system, a newer type design, shown to provide significant pollutant removal. The park and ride, which is about 1.2 acres of impervious area, was basically just draining to a catch basin, which was sat right in the middle of this gravel wetland, which was then connected to a pipe, which was just piped directly to the stream. A lot of the treatment is actually going on in the subsurface. There's a gravel layer under this wetland. The elevations are set up such that the pressure of the water coming in is pushing it horizontally through the stone. It's a very controlled release. You're getting removal of the pollutants through physical, chemical, and biological processes, and then you're also getting flow control. Historically, stormwater treatment has been kind of placed in the back lots away from public view. And now, you know, the idea is that we're trying to bring it out more and integrate it into the landscape.
Individual design elements form the technical foundation for non-point source solutions. As we expand our lens and begin to comprehend the complexity of the stormwater challenge, we realize that broad system solutions are required. certain regions have committed more resources to large-scale solutions. Portland, Oregon has made significant progress in the implementation of stormwater design.
Portland really got into stormwater over a long time period. We realized that as we developed, we had more and more impervious area. We realized also that a number of regulations were coming to bear. We just wanted to do the proactive, the correct thing in terms of managing our stormwater. Previously, people have always thought of stormwater as a waste. When you recognize it as a resource and capture it where it falls, you open up tremendous opportunities. How can we do stormwater management, but also improve and enhance our communities at the same time?
Throughout the city of Portland, you'll find many vegetated areas, though you may not recognize them as intentionally designed stormwater elements. Water is conveyed through vegetated facilities where it is cleaned and absorbed by this green infrastructure. Green streets have been developed, where curb cuts allow water flow into planted streetscapes that become community assets without taking up valuable parking space.
As a stormwater utility, we charge every property owner a stormwater fee. However, if you manage the water that falls on your site using vegetated means, then you have a break or a discount on your stormwater charge. So we recognize your contribution to helping us with the system-wide approach.
Here in Vermont, South Burlington was one of the first in New England to initiate a stormwater utility.
What we've learned in South Burlington is that you have to deal with the development on a more visionary basis to try to control stormwater amongst other things. This is an area that was of prime concern, one of the first areas that the stormwater utility dealt with. We had areas that were washing out over time because of the rush of water. It was creating huge erosion and creating a lot of sediment flowing into the brook. What they've done is, through the stormwater utility, is actually create wetlands that let the sediment settle out from the water as it moves through these stabilized banks. We've put in riprap along the edge of the stream to protect the bank, keep it from eroding. We've planted grasses in the area and other plants that will hold water. Another component of the stormwater facility that we're in is these trees here and the constructed wetlands around us. These were created to allow sediment to settle out from the water before it continued on into the stream. These trees are here along with the grasses to help stabilize this bank to keep it from eroding. Back before this was done, this was an area of tremendous erosion. This is not about reinventing the wheel. It's about finding ways to protect that lake, the jewel of Vermont.
We're actively engaged right now in the state of Vermont to look at whether we need to make changes to the law to encourage more stormwater utilities at the local level, maybe at the regional level, maybe even at the statewide level, because there really isn't a community in this state that shouldn't be thinking about how to better manage and control its stormwater.
Obviously, before buildings were here, I mean, 100% of the land was permeable. As we build buildings, you know, we've now gotten it so in urban landscapes, I mean, we're 98% impermeable. And now we're looking at ways, how do we bring that back?
Environmentally, we wanted a light footprint. The stormwater piece was an important part. We're here at the Heritage Aviation General Aviation Facility at the Burlington International Airport. The building itself has a green roof on the saddlebags, the four saddlebags around the building that capture and slow the runoff from the building. It really took off. It's gorgeous. I mean, and people come in, they're very appreciative of it. It's very calming to go up there. The building captures like 99% of the runoff, and it goes to an underground 30,000 gallon underground storage tank. The calculations show that roughly a 1-inch rainfall fills the tank. So if there's a 1-inch rainfall event, it's completely captured in the tank and never goes off-site at all. We draw off of that tank to irrigate the green roof and the trees and shrubs on site. In addition, we use the water to wash aircraft and also to wash the floors of the hangar. We installed the largest pervious concrete parking lot in New England, which even in the heaviest rainstorms that we have, the water vanishes through the parking lot, so it's not collected, and therefore it doesn't concentrate contaminants. Between the two, the site work and the building, there is effectively zero stormwater runoff. A project like this, you know, it's big to us locally, I mean, but it's very small. When you get on Google Earth and look down at it, it's a much less than a postage stamp, depending on what scale you use. It's a tiny little speck. The rain has been coming in increasingly intense rainfall events, and so stormwater is an issue very much on the map right now because of the runoff and the flooding. I'm in the camp that would argue there is a responsibility of businesses and business leaders to consider these issues and implement what they are able to at the time of construction. It was an opportunity, we took the shot, and we're pleased with what we've ended up with.
Urban stormwater issues are addressed through stormwater utilities and green infrastructure. As we move out from our urban centers, we are confronted with a different set of challenges.
Go back 50, 60, 70 years. People didn't live in suburban developments. They didn't exist. This was a World War II invention, or when all the people came back and the boomers generation began to be born, there was a need for lots of housing. And so the strategy was suburbanization. And it made a lot of sense because you could put it up fast. South Village Community is 220 acres surrounded by conventional quarter acre lot developments that mostly all use chemicals to keep their lawns green. Could we do something different? What if we hold all of our stormwater on site? And how could we do that? The way they did that is they concentrated the development to only one quarter of the 220 acres, and the other land was left open and actually has a restoration plan and methodology and financing scheme to make it a healthier place to capture that stormwater and hold it and clean it. And another big piece of the land is an area that we wanted to figure out how to farm and grow food. So when someone moved into the development, they could actually move into a situation where the food was being produced on site. So here we're producing food on site for the people who live here. We're producing energy with a solar array, and through an interesting financing mechanism, funding the restoration of the land. Ultimately, we're going to have to reinvent ourselves, forced by peak oil and the uncertainty of energy supplies and the increasing cost of energy supplies. So eventually, economics will make this logical, just like economics made suburbanization logical.
We're getting essentially free services from nature. Nature built us a water purification plant in the form of a forest or a wetland. If we destroy that, it's like we're destroying our own water purification plant. And so someone should have to pay for that, right? If a developer comes in and owns that forest or that wetland and destroys it, should they be able to get away with that for free? When in fact now it's going to exert a cost on the rest of the downstream users.
If you don't measure the cost of pollution or depletion or sprawl, then the economic system cannot respond to it.
We have to have different kinds of what we call economic indicators. Recently, here in the state of Vermont, we were told that we had one of the strongest gross domestic products of any state in the country. Now, that's good news. On the other hand, this year we also saw median family income go down. We saw major cuts in important programs that low-income people rely on. We know that hunger is on the increase. So how do we have a stronger, more gross domestic product if we have an economy that's really in a shambles?
The GDP counts everything that goes through the economy. It doesn't separate between benefits and costs. We don't measure the costs of growth.
Every time that we do something on the planet, we have two choices in front of us. We have the choice of looking at how can that create a new ecological niche? How can it do something that actually enhances the environment and literally is positive? And or we can be going out there and just taking more resources, using them, and basically downcycling and lowering, you know, what the world is.
If we could come up with some sort of a regional governance strategy that could look at the watershed and take a whole watershed approach and somehow finance restoration of ecosystems based on people's willingness to pay for those services, I think we'd have a real winner on our hands.
The lesson you learned back in grade 6, that you can't run out of water and you can't destroy it, is not true. Yes, the same amount of water is still here on the planet somewhere as was here millions of years ago, but we are taking water from where we can access it, clean, accessible water, and we are doing bad things to it, displacing it, destroying it, and polluting it. You don't have to be a scientist. You don't have to be an environmental lawyer or whatever. You don't have to be an expert to care. We're going to have to build a new reverence for water. And remember, this belongs to us all. It belongs to other species. It belongs to the ecosystem. It belongs as much to future generations as it does to us. And we have a responsibility to take care of it so that it is there for those generations.